Who was Jesus, peace be upon him? Who was he? What was his nature? What was his substance? Was he of the same substance of the Father, meaning that he was God, that they were of the same substance? Or was he of similar substance, meaning was he the Son of God, begotten, but yet not fully God? Was he part man and part God? Or was he of a different substance, which some churches claim, such as some of the Northern African churches? Was he of a completely different nature? Was God of one nature and Jesus of a completely different and contradictory nature? What was the reality?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh to all of my brothers and sisters, and welcome to our guests. As Muslims, we begin everything by saying Bismillah, in the name of the one true creator of all that exists, and we say about him, Alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to the one true creator of all that exists. Wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah, and may the peace and blessings of the creator be upon his most noble messenger Muhammad and all of the messengers before him. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and we bear witness that nothing has the right to be given worship except that one true creator. Wahdahu la sharika la, and he is one alone and has no partners. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu, and we bear witness that indeed Muhammad ibn Abdullah is indeed the final messenger of the creator. Now, the task before me, first and foremost, I feel like I should be speaking this in Norwegian. Everything has been, I've understood nothing until the point where they introduced me, alhamdulillah. But inshallah, the creator willing, you will understand my speech. And I will try to slow down the way I speak. I speak very rapidly, unfortunately. But I will slow it down as much as possible. And if I begin to speed up too much to where it's unintelligible, please someone let me know. The task before me is actually very complicated, because in 2-hour time frame, which is separated into 2 55-minute segments, is scarcely enough time to describe the man and message of Jesus, peace be upon him, especially when I am trying to conduct this in the most academic as well as the most logical methodology that I can, taking 15 years, going on 16, 17 years of my research, compiling it into 2 hours is greatly difficult. But I will do my best, and the creator willing, some of you will gain something out of it. Now, before we get started, how many people in this room are not Muslim right now? You're not a Muslim. Raise your hand. High up. We have about 10. Okay, perfect. Hopefully we can do something about that. That's my goal. Anyway, it's not in my hands. Now, the goal of this lecture, and the goal of these two lectures, is simply in briefly to put forward not only my research, and as well as putting in other scholarly research into the message of Jesus, peace be upon him, not only from the biblical perspective, but a historical perspective. And then in the second part, in the second half, to give the Islamic perspective, to give the Islamic message of Jesus, trying to use the historical documents of the canon as well as the Quran, and trying to show why the two are so variant. Why the two are so variant in many places, but there is some similarities. Now, secondly, I want to apologize that my speech is going to be a bit slower. It's going to be a bit muddled. I've been suffering from the flu for about a week now. It was actually quite difficult for me to get here. I got some nasty bug when I was in Dubai. So if I happen to just run off the stage suddenly, know that it is for a very, very good reason. And I'll be back. Just as a disclaimer. And also, I'm going to be summarizing a lot of information. So I'm not going to be able to give you A to Z. I'm not going to be able to tell you A to Z, all of the information at hand, because it's impossible. It is impossible in the context of 2 hours to give you all the information that is necessary. But I will tell you how you can get some more of that information at the end of the lecture the Creator willing. Now, when it comes to Jesus, the Christ, and yes, we have no problems as Muslims in saying the Christ coming from the Greek word Christos, which means the Anointed One or the Messiah. And in the Quran, he is known as Al-Masih, the Anointed One, the Messiah, etc. So we have no problem with Jesus the Christ. When it comes to Jesus, peace be upon him, from the historical documents that we find in the canon, which is, when I say the canon for the rest of this lecture, the canon will refer to the books according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, or titled after Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who unfortunately did not write these documents. Historically and biblically and scholarly, we found this information. But when I say the canon, this is what I will be referring to. From the historical documents of the canon, as well as some of the other documents which are known as Apocrypha, etc., we see that Jesus, peace be upon him, was a man. And I will speak later on to this issue of him being a man and how he was viewed as a man, not only by his disciples, but all of those who were around him viewed him as a man. He was a man who was sent by the Creator to his people, And there are a number of verses to point to that fact, where Jesus, peace be upon him, very clearly said, I was not sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He was sent to his people, the children of Israel, or the Jews as you would know it. And we find no historical evidence that is verifiable that Jesus in his lifetime, during his mission, before the issue of the trial and following stories of the crucifixion we will try to touch on as well, do we find Jesus preaching to anyone other than his people? He was sent to his people to bring them back to the worship of the one true Creator of all that exists. He was sent to his people to bring them back to following the law that was sent to them through Moses, peace be upon him, the Torah. And he himself was a follower of that law. But he also was sent to modify or to perfect and complete and finalize the law of Moses. He was sent to adjust some things. For those who believed in him, he was sent to ease up some of the harsh restrictions that were placed on the children of Israel due to their years and years and years and years and years of disobedience. Their law was restricted very, very much. And Jesus was sent to modify that and to lax it a little bit for those who believed in him. This was the mission of Jesus Christ. He himself worshipped one God alone. He himself prayed to one God alone. He himself followed the law of Moses. He himself ardently followed the law. He himself was someone who followed every single commandment to its perfection and its fulfillment. He worshipped the way that Moses worshipped, one God alone. He fasted the way that Moses fasted, following in the footsteps of the messengers. He himself believed in circumcision, as was the law, and he himself was circumcised. He never ate pork, not once ever in his life. He never partook of alcohol. Even the verse where apparently his first mission in the canon is to turn the water to wine, we don't find this in the ancient documents. In the ancient manuscripts, such as the, and I will refer to these documents later on, the Codex Sinaiticus and the Codex Vaticanus, we don't see these documents existing, that Jesus turned water into wine. So he never partook of these things. He himself, he followed the law. He observed the Sabbath, as was commanded in the law of Moses. He followed that which he preached. He preached a message of worshiping God alone and following the law of God as a means to salvation. And he himself practiced what he preached. He was the first and foremost to practice what he himself preached. Now, what I'm going to try to discuss in my first part of this lecture is how did we get from a Jesus, peace be upon him, who worshipped one God alone, and followed the law of Moses to perfection, to the best of his abilities, to a religion which now we find that the majority of Christianity, especially when it comes to Trinitarian Christianity or Orthodox Christianity, we find a totally different way of life. We find a Trinity, that there is one God in three separate personages, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all three being God, but yet distinct in their natures, being that God the Father is not like God the Son, God the Son is not like God the Spirit, and God the Spirit is not like the Son, and the Athanasian Creed that God is the Father, God is the Son, God is the Holy Spirit, but the Father is not the Son, and the Son is not the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is not the Father. How did we get from this to that? How did we get to a Christianity which observes things such as Christmas, such as Easter, and other things like this that Jesus himself never followed, never practiced? Where did all this come from? I'm going to take on a small journey. And if I had the time, and if I could keep you here for days, then I would be able to relate to you all this information. But I have been spending 15 years to try to do this through my research, through my videos, through my DVDs, and through a book which the Creator willing, inshallah, I am hoping to finish later this year. Now, as Jesus preached this, he at some point left this earth after 33 years. He was gone. And we will talk about how that happened and what happened according to not only the canonical documents, but as well as the Quranic perspective, and why the canon cannot be trusted as in a reference to Jesus, yet the Quran is a pure source of information. We will discuss that as well. We go from that to what happened now. Now, when Jesus, peace be upon him, left this earth, the people who followed him, who were known as his disciples and some of his followers, they continued for the first three decades, after the death of Jesus, peace be upon him. And this is proven through the Acts, the book of Acts of the apostles within the Bible, as well as in the historical references. We find that the people who followed Jesus and his disciples, they did not branch out and begin to start their own religion. They did not start building houses of worship to worship Jesus Christ and to worship the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do not find them branching out and calling Jesus God. What we find from these disciples and Jesus' followers is that they continue to still be a part and parcel of Judaism. They continue to go to the synagogue, the house of worship. They continue to follow the law of Moses. They continued to follow the way of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And they did so very, very religiously. This is what we find within the first three decades. And this has been proven by a number of biblical scholars. This is not something I decided backstage that I was going to present to you as information. But we find this from the very early church fathers, such as Josephus, Irenaeus. We find this from the historical documents as well, that they did this. Now, there was a man who was bent on destroying the followers of Jesus Christ. He persecuted them. He killed them. He would round them up and have them killed in front of people as a form of entertainment. He enjoyed it very much. And he became a leader in those who persecuted the followers of Jesus Christ, which Christianity means the following or the religion of Christ, the following of Jesus Christ. The people who followed Jesus were persecuted very fiercely. And this is something that is not new. All of the followers of the prophets very early on were always persecuted. Now, there was a man who led this tirade of destroying and persecuting and abusing the followers of Jesus Christ. And his name was Saul. He was a man of Saul from Tarsus. Now, Saul was himself a Jew. He was himself a man who was learned in the law of Moses. He was a man who was learned in the religion of Judaism. And he despised and detested what Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was about, as well as what his followers were teaching and were following themselves. He was amicably opposed to it 100%. So he began to persecute these followers. Now, the more he persecuted them, the more they grew. The larger the following came, the more people he martyred. And we know of some of the early martyrs of Jesus, peace be upon him, including so-called the John the Baptist in the Bible was martyred, and some others were martyred. It seems as if the more people he martyred, the greater their following came. Because people realized something, that if people were willing to die, if people were willing to put their lives on the line, if people were willing to go to the sword, if people were willing to be burned at the stake, if people were willing to go through all of this and not abandon that which they were practicing, then this must be something. There must be something behind this. And it also reminds me of a story when a man questioned one of the contemporaries of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, about his followers. He said, do they leave the religion once they are entering it? You're persecuting them, you guys are killing them, you guys are doing... Are they leaving the religion? He said, no. He said, truly indeed, this is the way it is of the true religion. People don't leave it once they enter it. So these people weren't leaving. They were being martyred for it, and people were becoming more interested in what they were preaching and teaching, and the followings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, began to grow. So apparently this scenario wouldn't work. It's not working. So Saul of Tarsus comes up with another plan. He comes up with another plan. And we find this as well in the Acts of the Apostles and in the writings of Paul himself, which make up the compendium of the New Testament, as well as 99.99% of the teachings of modern-day Trinitarian Christianity are from Paul. It should be called Paulianity, to be frankly honest. It should be Paulianity, because what we find in the teachings of Paul, later on I will show you, in the teachings of Jesus, are in complete contradiction to one another. They're like water and oil. They're like fresh water and salt water. They don't mix. I don't care how much you try to mix them and shake them and pour them together. If you let it sit long enough, they will sift. Now, this man Saul of Tarsus, he claims at some point that when he was on the road to Damascus in Syria, when he was on the road to Damascus, he saw a vision. And in this vision, Jesus, peace be upon him, appeared to Paul. Now, the only evidence we have of this incident is the words of Paul himself. That's it. No one else witnessed this incident. Saul himself says that he saw in a vision that Jesus, peace be upon him, told him that he was his chosen disciple. That he himself was the chosen disciple of Jesus, and that he was going to teach him properly his way. Forget about what the disciples are doing. The disciples who witnessed Jesus in his lifetime learned directly from him. Paul now, who had never met Jesus, he never spoke to Jesus while Jesus was alive, he never interacted with him, is now Jesus' chosen disciple, and he changes his name from Saul of Tarsus to Paul. One of the reasons? To disdain his former reputation. He didn't want to be known as that man who persecuted Christianity anymore. He changed his name to Paul. Now, initially, people were very apprehensive of Paul. I mean, this is the same guy who used to kill us and slaughter us. He is now coming and saying that, you know, he is a believer in Jesus Christ. He is a follower of the messenger, Jesus. Now, the first person Paul is to interact with is a man named Barnabas. And Barnabas was a very, very close friend to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. He is also someone who himself wrote a gospel. He did write a gospel. Now, the gospel of Barnabas has problematic issues in reference to its origin. We have trouble tracing its following origin. But there's also a letter of Barnabas that we find within the Apocrypha, and it's also part of the Codex Sinaiticus, and parts of it are in the Codex Vanaticus. Now, this letter is more sound than the gospel, but nevertheless, Barnabas himself was a close consort and disciple and follower of Jesus, peace be upon him, and one of those who taught the religion of Jesus, peace be upon him, after his death. Now, Barnabas took Paul at his face value. That, look, this man says he has had an epiphany. He's had a conversion to the proper religion of Jesus Christ. So he took him at his word, and this is the way the believer should be. If someone comes to you and says, look, I am a believer. I am now a Muslim. I believe there's only one God worthy of worship, and I believe that at this time Muhammad is the messenger. We take them at that face value unless something later on proves it otherwise. So Barnabas took him in and began to work with him. And also introduced him to the other disciples of Jesus, who were at first apprehensive, but it was Barnabas's affirmation that no, he's serious, that the disciples took him in. And Barnabas even traveled with Paul the Apostle for a period of time. Now, as Paul is traveling with Barnabas, you would guess that he would come on to the right way, that he would follow the way of the apostles. But at some point, Paul decides to break off from Barnabas and break off from all the apostles, cut his connections, cut his ties with them, and he decides that they are, number one, ignorant and lazy. They don't really have a fervor to preach the true gospel of Jesus. And he himself had that authority because Jesus was revealing to him through visions the proper way of following him, the proper methodology. And that Jesus revealed to him that he himself was God, and that God was three in one, and that the law was no longer needed, and all of these things that we will talk about later on. And Paul begins to preach his own brand of what he calls Christianity. Paul does a lot of things. First and foremost, he goes against everything that Jesus did, everything the apostles did, in that he begins to preach to the Gentiles, meaning the people who were not from the tribes of Judah, who were not from the children of Israel. He begins to preach to them, something Jesus himself never did, and something the apostles of Jesus, the disciples of Jesus, never did. He says that the world has been opened to him to preach to the Gentiles, so he begins to preach to the Greeks, and he begins to preach to the Romans and other pockets of the Galileans and the Gentiles of his time. Now, at first, a lot of what Paul is going to say, he knows not going to be accepted. Because the Greeks, the Romans, and the other Gentiles of his time, they were pagan. They were polytheists. They worshipped a plethora of gods. They worshipped a triune god in Greek and Roman mythology. There is a triune god. There is gods that, such as Adonis and Dionysus and things of this nature, who were considered to be God in the flesh, who died for the sins of humanity, were resurrected, ascended to heaven, sat on the right hand of the Creator. You have the gods such as Thor. You have gods such as Zeus and things of that nature. So they had this idea of a unity of gods, all many gods into one God and things of that nature. So Paul begins to modify Christianity slightly at first in order to make it more acceptable. Let's water it down a bit. Let's dumb it down a bit so that he can get some backing from these people. Because the disciples were not going to be in agreement with this. They were not. And we do see at one point where Barnabas and Paul meet again and they have a huge disagreement. There's a huge disagreement about what Paul is teaching. But Paul begins to modify this teaching and comes forward to teach that number one he has to do is to abolish the law. The law has to be abolished. It has to be. This law that Jesus himself, peace be upon him, followed every single day of his life, to the day he left this earth, Paul does away with it. This law is no longer needed. Now, this very law we will come to see later on is something that Jesus, peace be upon him, says not only should be followed, but it is the path to salvation. That in order to obtain salvation, in order to inherit eternal life, in order to go to heaven, you must worship God and follow his law. You must worship God, obey God, follow his commandments. Paul takes all of this and throws it out the window and says that Jesus himself has given him the ability that everything is permissible. Everything is permissible for him. Everything is lawful for him because the law is something that was accursed of God. Law, and Paul quotes in Galatians, a letter that he wrote to the people at Galatia. He writes to them and asks them, why are they still following the law? Because the law itself cannot bring one to salvation. The law is imperfect. Man is imperfect of following the perfect law. Man is imperfect of following the perfect law. Therefore, the law itself is no longer needed. With the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross, this law is abolished. He said, Jesus Christ was accursed by the law, meaning the crucifixion, we'll talk about that in the second part, in order to remove us from the curse of the law. And he calls the law itself a curse. For it is written, and he quotes a verse in Deuteronomy, everything that hangeth on a tree, meaning everything that is crucified, is accursed of God. Now, this is extremely problematic because this is a new invention of Paul. We see throughout the entirety of the Old Testament, through the entirety of the books of the Old Testament, God is commanding people to follow his law. We find through the canon of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, that Jesus Christ is commanding people to follow the law. He himself is following the law. In a verse that is quoted in Matthew, according to Matthew, whoever wrote Matthew, Jesus supposedly said, proposedly, that whosoever shall obey the least of the law, the smallest part of the law, and he shall teach people to obey the law, he will be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall break the law, even the smallest of it, and he shall teach other people to break the law, he will be the least in the kingdom of heaven. The least in the kingdom of heaven. And here we have Paul, the so-called new apostle of Jesus, telling people that the law is no longer needed. Why? Because the law and what Paul is in teaching is in contradiction to one another. The two cannot melt. The two cannot mix. Paul can only continue to teach his brand of Christianity by abolishing that law. That law must go. Because the very, very first of the law, Jesus, and we'll talk about this and quote it again, Jesus was asked by a scholar of the Jewish law, what is the greatest law? And Jesus said, I cannot tell you the greatest law without telling you the first law. And the first law, he quoted the Shema, or the quotation that Judaism and Jews use every single service. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. And the oneness that is used, Ashad, in the Hebrew language means a oneness that cannot be added to, a oneness that cannot be subtracted from, a oneness that is unique, all of its own, a unified oneness, alone, set apart from everything else. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one alone. This was the first of the law. So in order for Paul to bring about a concept that Jesus was God, that God is God, and that the Holy Spirit is also God, and these three together are God, he has to get rid of the law. The law and this do not melt. Also, Paul has to do away with the practices of Judaism or the practices of the law of Moses as it was. Now, Paul also has trouble dealing with the Greeks and the Romans, the Gentiles, because they are following something, their way of life was something totally 100% contradictory and opposed to the religion or the teachings of Jesus Christ as he preached them on this earth. So in order for them to accept this, in order for them to take this, Paul waters it down very much and adds many things to it, such as the Trinity. The Trinity is something that, as I said, that these Greeks, Romans, Gentiles, many other religions, Hinduism, Buddhism has a Trinity, Taoism has a Trinity. All of these religions have some type of triune entity within their religion. So Paul comes up with this idea of a Trinity, the God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. These three are one. These three are one unique being. And says to them, look, you already believe this. You already have this type of idea. And you will even find, I've even had some ministers, some pastors, some preachers tell me that no, Paul didn't invent this. The reason that there are these triune gods in other religions is that God was preparing them. That God had sent this to them long ago. Long ago, in order to prepare them to accept the true teachings of Jesus Christ. Allah musta'an. It is the Creator's help that is sought for all of this. But he said, look, you're already believing in this triune system of gods. We have the same thing. You are close. All you need to do is call it what I'm calling it. So for them, this is very simple. No problem. We can do this. Also, the sacrifices such as the anointing of the blood and the water and the sacraments, such as the taking of the bread, taking of the wine, simulating Jesus' blood. All of this you find within Greek mythology. You find it within Roman mythology. You find it within other pagan religions, that this sacrament of taking and eating the flesh of their God and drinking the blood of their God, all of this you find within this. So he said, yes, this is as well with us, that Jesus, peace be upon him, died for the sins of humanity. Therefore, eating from his flesh is worship, drinking from his blood ceremoniously is worship. So these things were incorporated into their lifestyle. All you need to do is give it a new label. You need to give it a new label. Very simple. Same religion that you have, I have. Just we have a new label. It's called Christianity. And the same way like you worship Thor, the same way like you worship Odin, the same way like you worship Zeus, the same way like you worship Adonis, Jesus, peace be upon him, is just like them. Just like them. Maybe even a new reincarnation of them. Who knows? Who knows what Paul may have said behind closed doors to get these Greeks and Gentiles and Romans to start entering into the religion that he has created, calling it Christianity. Now, and also the laws of the Jews, they don't have to worry about that, because this was a big problem for the Greeks and the Gentiles. They had no law. Their law was to eat, drink, and be merry. So he told them, look, the law is gone. You can do as you wish. As long as you believe in this, as long as you believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is God in the flesh, the begotten Son, and he died on the cross for the sins of humanity, and you accept that, then you go into heaven. After that, do whatever you like. Do whatever you like because your sins are covered in the blood of Christ. So they were very willing to accept this. Very, very willing to accept this. So the Greeks and the Romans and the other Gentiles began to fall into the religion of Christianity. Now, when they started to outnumber the followers, the true followers of Jesus, when Paul began to have a following that was giving him some power, and he started to get the backing of the Roman Empire, he started to get the backing of the Greeks, he started to get in the backing of the other Gentiles, then now Paul is able to push forward his way. He's able to push forward his way and claim that everyone else that does not follow this way has misunderstood Jesus. Misunderstood Jesus. That you cannot always take Jesus at his words. And this is passed down even to today. That you cannot take Jesus at his words. Jesus never speaks literally. Never speaks literally. When he said that God was one, he meant that he was one in three. When he said this, he meant that. Tabarakallah. We say that, you know, it is amazing that Paul can be taken literally. Paul, the so-called apostle, can be taken literally. And the words of Jesus are taken metaphorically. Yet the words of Paul are used to interpret the words of Jesus, peace be upon him. We take the words of Paul and interpret the words of Jesus in the light of the words of Paul. And this is the religion of modern-day Trinitarian Christianity. And it's indeed a crime. This is a grievous crime upon logic. It's a grievous crime upon sanity to take the words of a man who never met Jesus and take them literally to interpret the words of the person to whom was revealed the true way of life. But this is what modern day Christianity has become. Also, when the followers of Paul, after time had passed, we say into the first century, the second century of Christianity, people who had begun to follow Paul and had started to outnumber the true followers of Jesus Christ, when they were questioned about what they were teaching, where did you get this information from? They couldn't just say, okay, Paul said this, because this wouldn't have been accepted at that time. Who is Paul? We're talking about, where did you get this from the teachings of Jesus Christ? This is also, and I wish I had the time, I wish I had the context to go through with you many, many, many references that are used within Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to prove Paul's statements. You will find them if you look very hard, if you search very deeply, you will find them to be later additions by the church, later alterations by the church. And biblical scholars have come to this conclusion themselves. And there was even a Bible established in the 50s called the New Revised Standard Version, where many biblical scholars try to be just, they try to be honest and come forward and say, look, there are many things that we found that are not part of the ancient manuscripts of the Bible that were later additions and later modifications to the scriptures by well-meaning and sometimes not so well-meaning scribes and people who inserted things within these documents in order to make them fit in with what they were teaching and preaching at the time. You will find that this is what happened, is that when these followers of Paul were being questioned about what they were teaching and preaching, and where do you get this from the teachings of Jesus Christ, you'll find that this is where additions came in. Things had to be added. Things had to be removed. Things had to be modified. Words had to be changed in order for what they say and were saying to be taken. And you'll also have to understand that it was an easy task to do at that time because a very small portion of the population was literate. A very small portion of the population could actually go to these documents, look at them themselves, and see that these were additions or alterations or detractions because they were illiterate. So they just had to take the reading. That look, here's it says it right here. This is what it says. This is what Jesus, peace be upon him, says. And they took that. It wasn't until the world became very literate and we also were gained access to some of these ancient manuscripts, especially such as the finding of the Codex Sinaiticus and the Codex Vanaticus, that we start to see that these are later additions into Christianity. Now, in the fourth century, this is where the one of the greatest crimes after Paul's alterations of the religion of Jesus, the greatest crimes come into play. And this is where we're going to try to wrap it up. And I'm only starting you on a road. I'm trying to start you down a path to the best of my ability. In the 4th century, there was a war going on amongst Christianity and amongst the various branches of Christianity. And if you want to have full information about this, I will suggest to you to get a book called Lost Christianities, Faiths and Religions That We Never Knew Of, by Bart Ehrman, who is a leading foremost scholar in biblical studies and textual criticism at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, in Durham, North Carolina, in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. He was a student of Bruce Metzger. He graduated from Moody Bible Institute. He was an evangelical who went over into a literary Christian and then left Christianity in its entirety due to his studies as well. But he wrote a book called Lost Christianities, The Struggles for Faith and Religions That We Never Knew. There was a war going on within Christianity. You had the Greek Orthodox Church, you had the Roman Catholic Church, you had the Northern African churches, you had all of these different churches who were saying that we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in his message, but they were in varying factions about the details. One of the things that was of huge discussion in the 4th century was, who was Jesus, peace be upon him? Who was he? What was his nature? What was his substance? Was he of the same substance of the Father, meaning that he was God, that they were of the same substance? Or was he of similar substance, meaning was he the Son of God, begotten, but yet not fully God? Was he part man and part God? Or was he of a different substance, which some churches claim, such as some of the Northern African churches? Was he of a completely different nature? Was God of one nature and Jesus of a completely different and contradictory nature? What was the reality? And there were many meetings that were held, and this began when the Romans, and especially the leaders, and the leader of Rome at the time, had his supposed conversion to Christianity. He converted to Christianity and said, look, I'm going to establish Christianity as the official religion of the Roman Empire, but it's only going to be one. It's only going to be one. We can't say that we are a unified nation, we are a unified people, yet we have a disunified religion. So he commanded that all of the bishops, meaning all of the leaders of the various churches, descend upon Rome. Of course, it had to be held in Rome. Descend upon Rome, and the Roman church at the time was one of the most prevalent churches, the Roman Catholic Church, who did believe that Jesus and God were of the same substance, because they were reading from the letters of Paul. Their main construct to interpret the life of Jesus Christ was the letters and writings of Paul. The North African churches had other documents to interpret the life of Paul, such as the Gospel of Timothy, such as the Gospel of Barnabas, and such of this nature. They had other documents to which they interpreted the life of Jesus Christ. So meetings were held in Rome in a city called Nicaea, called the Councils of Nicaea, and there were a couple of them. Now, in these councils, they were to discuss these important matters and to come up with, number one unified belief, that we are going to codify our beliefs, that we are going to believe A, B, C, D, E, F, G. We're going to codify the books that we will believe in, because there were many books out, many different things being said. We're going to codify the books which we're going to believe in, and you're not going to leave this meetings, you're not going to get out of this until you have come up with the solutions. Now, what began to happen was a political process. Political process. And this happens today in many of our esteemed governmental gatherings, such as in houses of parliament, such as in congresses, such as in constitutional boards. What happens is that people come together and start vying for positions of power. It's not about what is right and what is wrong. It's not about what is truth and what is not truth. It's about our party winning over your party. Our party gaining the other hand and winning over your party. So the beginning of these councils were not so much so as trying to define these things, more so as each of these different groups vying to bring the other over to their side. Look, this is what you believe, come to our side. We have the upper hand.
We have the upper hand. You don't want to be on the wrong side of this vote. Put it that way. You don't want to find yourself on the wrong side of this vote. Because when this was codified, when this was established, everybody who was on the outside would be called heretical. Everyone on the outside would be considered a criminal. And their books would be burned. Their tongues and sometimes would be cut out. They would be killed. They would be persecuted. They would be stamped out of existence. So you didn't want to be on the wrong side of that vote. And be it that this was held in Rome, guess who would be the majority rule? The Roman Catholic bishops. And the Northern African bishops, some of them were not able to attend. It's a long way to go in the fourth century, all the way to from Northern Africa to Rome. So what happened was these things were established within the Council of Nicaea. It wasn't so much so an academic process as it was a diplomatic process. And what came out at the end of these councils is what is known as the Creed of Nicaea, the Nicene Creed. The Nicene Creed is established that God is one, but in three unique personages, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. All three are of the exact same substance as God. You have the other creeds, such as the Athanasian Creed, which is also adopted as being proper. And the books that would be followed were number one. The number one books that would be followed were not the teachings of Jesus Christ himself. It was the letters of and epistles of Paul the Apostle. That makes up the compendium of the New Testament. The majority of the New Testament that is followed by Christianity today is the teachings and writings and letters of Paul. And then they chose the Gospels according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which themselves are of dubious origin. Of dubious origin. No one can tell you exactly who wrote these books. No one can tell you exactly where these books came from. And there is no original sourcing. And there is no chain of evidence for these documents. And according to church fathers, such as Irenaeus, such as Josephus, we know that the oldest of the documents is Mark, dating to somewhere around 60-something years after Jesus, peace be upon him. And Mark himself was not writing a first-hand account. Whoever wrote Mark, according to many church fathers, was not writing of his own witness. He was copying from another document called the Q document, which does not exist. And we only know of it because of its reference by some of the fathers, the church leaders of the first century after Jesus, peace be upon him. So Mark got his information from a document called the Q document. And then Luke, whoever wrote Luke, copied from Mark with additions that he starts off by disclaiming in the beginning that I am telling you those things which seem good to me. The things which I am hearing that sound good at my time, I am telling you these things. But he also pulled information from Mark, but put it in a different fashion. And then Matthew came along, copied from Luke. We see that in some of the scriptural and the scribal writings, that these were copies and documents from Luke. And then we have the synoptic gospel of John, which is totally different from all other three gospels, which its origin is very dubious and is the oldest of the four canon gospels. This, put together with the Acts of the Apostles and a couple of other books, became what Christians must believe, what they must read, and what they must believe to be the very words of God, inerrant, without error, without mistake. Little did these church fathers know that there would be a literary boom and an academic boom, that people would go and study these things and come to find out that these were not truly inerrant and were not truly the inspired words of God, because we know God is not the author of confusion, as is quoted in Romans. Now, at this time, this became the birth of modern Christianity. The birth and infancy in the modern Christianity came in the fourth century. After this, anyone who did not believe in the Nicene Creed, anyone who did not believe what the Roman Catholic Church was believing, was considered heretical. Heretical. And history is replete. History is full of massive crimes against humanity performed on behalf of the Roman Catholic Church, sometimes at the very behest of the Pope himself, to exterminate anyone who did not believe in this. And if any of you have doubts about what I have said, just go and study something called the Inquisition. The Inquisition, which means the questioning. where people who said they were following Jesus would be questioned about their beliefs. And around 12 million at best estimate and best guesstimate, were exterminated and killed. And even just in the Netherlands, the Inquisition disposed of between 3 and 4 million men, women, and children were hung at the gallows because they did not believe what the Roman Catholic Church was presenting as the truth religion of Jesus Christ. The history is there for us. We just need to open a book. We need to open a book and go do a little bit of research for ourselves. This is the birth of modern day Christianity. And what we will come to find in the second part of this lecture is that modern day Christianity, Trinitarian Christianity, I don't have the opportunity to discuss all of the different brands of Christianity, such as Jehovah's Witnesses, such as Mormonism, such as Seventh-day Adventists, and things of this nature. It's not the context of our discussion. I am restricting myself to the majority of Christianity, which would be Trinitarian Christianity. What you will come to find out is that modern-day Christianity, Trinitarian Christianity, the Nicene Creed, the Athanasian Creed, the four canonical Gospels, the letters and epistles and teachings of Paul, are in 100% contradiction to what Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself taught. And I will use sparingly, I will use some of the documents of the New Testament. And I will only use documents from the Old Testament that you will find in the ancient manuscripts, the oldest of documents, such as in the Codex Sinaiticus and the Codex Vinaiticus and the older manuscripts. Only those things which we can trace back as far as we can trace back will I use, because this is what biblical scholars consider to be the most authentic of sources, which is also problematic because there's no original. We cannot verify for 100% that Jesus said any of these things we find in the canon, but I will use a few of them in correlation with the final revelation of humanity. The final revelation to humanity is the Quran, and it is the source of truth for every single Muslim, and it is the source of truth for humanity, and I will try to the best of my ability to show you that if you look in the oldest of manuscripts, the oldest of documents, forget about what Paul said, forget about what whoever wrote Mark said, forget about what whoever wrote Luke said. What these oldest documents ascribe to the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself. Meaning that if you took a Bible, if you took a Bible called the Red Letter Edition Bible. Now this Red Letter Edition Bible has the words that are directly supposed to be out of the mouth of Jesus. They have them written in red. So we will restrict ourselves to that alone, because Paul should not be an authority on what we should believe. Mark, Matthew, whoever wrote these books should not be an authority on what we believe. If you want to say that you believe in a religion called Christianity, the religion and the teachings of Jesus Christ, then it must come out of his mouth. And it cannot be interpreted in the light of what Paul taught. Cannot. That is a crime and will not be accepted. It must be out of the mouth of Jesus Christ himself, taken literally, as meaning he meant what he said. He meant what he said. Like if I said this tablecloth is, this is blue or purple? I'm a little bit colorblind, by the way. Blue, it's blue? This is blue. You can't go later on and say, no, he said it was beige. No, I didn't say that this was colored. I said it was blue. Very clear. So we take these statements of Jesus Christ that are clear cut, straight to the point, no interpretation needed, forget about everything else, and you will find that these teachings, if you really search, if you really take some time to do justice to yourself and verify information, which in Thessalonians, accordingly, Paul said, prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. Paul himself taught something which he himself did not do. Prove all things and follow and hold on to that which is good. If you prove all things and you look at the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself from the canon gospels, and I could go in if I had the time into the Apocrypha. I don't even like to call it Apocrypha because it gives it a stigma that it's not valid. If Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are valid, believe me, the Apocrypha are valid. because we have some more ancient documents of the Apocrypha than we do some of the writings of these so-called Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. If you take these teachings in a nutshell and look at what Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, taught, and you say you want to follow that, I want to follow what Jesus, peace be upon him, taught. I want to follow what Jesus preached. I want to follow what he practiced. You will find yourself following the exact same way that Muslims follow today. We pray the way Jesus prayed. And all of the other prophets in the Bible, they fell on their face and prayed. They bowed themselves and prayed. Prayed to whom? The one eternal creator of all that exists. You will find yourself following what Muslims follow. We fast the way Jesus fasts, the way Moses fasted. We fast systematically the way they did. We pay charity the way they paid charity, systematically. Some of us even dress the way Jesus dressed. There's nothing important about that. Other than everything that a Muslim does, he does so in emulation, in trying to mold his behavior, mold his character, even his dress, the way he eats, the way he drinks, or she drinks. And whenever I say he, please don't take it as a sign of dismissing the sisters and the women in the room. It's just the normal way of speaking. His is used in a general context. The way we eat, the way we drink, the way we dress, the way we get married, the way we get divorced, the way we sleep, everything we do it to emulate the prophets and messengers, because we believe they all had the same way of life. They all had the same conduct. They all had the same character. They all taught the same religion. They all followed a similar law. It was different in its construct for time and place, of course. One law cannot be the same 6,000 years ago as it is today, because the world is just different. Law needs to be different. But it was of the same substance and nature. We seek to follow that. And I behest any of our Christian counterparts in this room to do your own research. Don't take me at face value, because my verification is worth nothing. You can't go and say, well, I know this because this guy who came all the way from the West Coast of America said it, therefore it has to be true. Don't do that. Even one of our great scholars of Islam, one of the most knowledgeable people of this generation after of this nation after the companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, he was a man named Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, and he was a man who studied with companions. A man who studied with someone who was a companion, his teacher Na'fi, radiallahu an. He even said about himself that no one's words should be taken at face value. No one's words should be taken at face value without checking their source, except the man in this grave. And he was pointing to the grave of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. That Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the only one who should be taken at face value, and you can accept his word without any credentials. But for the rest of us, credentials are necessary. So take what I say, but verify it. Go check it. Go do your own research. Go do your own research. Because it is that research, the very research that I'm asking you to do, is the reason I am standing here today as a Muslim. It is 18 years ago, I began research into my own faith. I began research into my own book. I began research into what I believed. And what I came to find out is that what I believed was not in congruity with what my book taught. That what I believed was something totally different than what I found, not only that God himself teaches, but as well as what Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, teaches. So I had to make a choice in my life, either to follow Paul and continue upon the Christianity that I was raised upon, or to follow Jesus, peace be upon him. And that search to try to find the proper way of Jesus Christ is what eventually allowed me to see the truth of the Quran when I read it. When I read the verses which were recited at the beginning of this day, the beautiful verses from many different chapters of the Quran. When I read them, I was able to see them, that this is indeed the true teachings of Jesus Christ. It is in congruency what we find in the ancient documents. It is in congruency what we find in historical documents about Jesus Christ, how he ate, how he slept, how he lived, how he worshipped, how he fasted, how he prayed. All of this is in congruity with the Quran teaches. And alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to the Creator, that I entered into Islam almost 15 years ago. Alhamdulillah. So we're going to now take a break because it is time for the established prayer of Isha. And this is something that Muslims are very particular about, is our worship of the one Creator of all that exists, giving him his proper due right, as it should be. As Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all of your might, with all of your strength. And if you love your neighbor like you love yourself, then you will be upon the right way and the right religion. So we are going to take this time out to give the Creator his right. And after about 30 minutes, we will be back, directly back. So nobody leave. It's not over yet. This is intermission. We're going to find the end of the information afterwards. Wa jazakum khairan. May Allah reward all of you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.